Hey folks, Jacob here, aka Necrosis. This is now my second video, and I think I've learned a few things from watching my first one that I need to work on. Two biggest issues were not using into the microphone when I talk, and the other was... What was the other one? Oh, that's right, not breathing into the microphone. So I'm trying something a little bit different. Most of my microphone settings are still about the same. I'm just trying not to talk into it so much with my mouth to it. But the way the system is designed, whether I'm talking to it like this or whether I'm whispering, it's still going to sound more or less the same. But right now I have music playing on the loudspeakers, and this thing is not picking it up. So why am I using a dynamic microphone instead of a condenser mic or desktop mic or something? Well, originally it was just because it was cheaper. Condenser mics are more expensive, they look a little more delicate, and they require phantom power, and while I have a mixer that has phantom power, I'd rather not use it if I don't have to. I've heard of issues with other devices being plugged in at the same time when the phantom power is on, potentially damaging them. I don't know if that's true or not. For me, it was a price thing, but later I found out that it's got a good side benefit, and that's the directional input, so to speak. If you don't talk to this thing straight on, if you're coming in from the side, it tends to become unlikely to pick noise up. And this is good because I can point this thing straight at me, and I have speakers going on either side of me. And like I said once before, they're PA speakers. They're loud. They're designed to shoot volume, but they're not hitting it head on. This thing is able to not pick it up, and yet I can still talk just like normal, and it, like, even though it's going through the gates, like, it's just, there's no noise in the background to get picked up. Part of that might also be due to the plugins, but so it ended up being a nice side benefit that worked really well for my situation. Either way, I don't know what most people use these days. I'm not in touch with reality at all. But if you have a choice, get one or the other, either a condenser mic or at least a dynamic mic. Get a mixer. A nice mixer will do you justice. I can't live without this thing. So my microphone goes into the mixer, and I'm going from the mixer rather than straight out to the speakers with the microphone. I'm not even using the sliders. I'm using one of the auxiliary outputs, and that's using a cable going right back into my sound card. That's my line input, and it's coming in at line volume. I've got everything calibrated, the pre-inputs, the pre-input gain, and I think part of it is also I got some EQ calibrate on there. That's for you to experiment. For me, it turned out turning down the lows a little bit and the highs a lot of it on the mixer for the microphone made a better signal going in. The purpose of this video is for me to talk about the microphone setup I'm using with Reroute and why I'm using a dynamic microphone rather than, say, a condenser mic or something. If you've got anything set up based on my previous video, then you pretty much, you're most of the way there already. There's not a whole lot different as far as configuring this stuff. It's just a matter of going into your properties for your sound device, going into the recording tab here, and picking out one cable It's going to be dedicated, I think, for just the input. I'm using my line in. That's what this says right here, is right, line in and microphone. And that's actually a virtual device, if I remember correctly, in my case. But if I turn everything on, I got other stuff. There's my mic. The Zonar, at least the DG, has a single port on the back that's either or microphone or line input. As far as I understand, if you're using just like a tabletop microphone or something that plugs in directly with a 3.5 millimeter cable, then you would want to use a mic setting in your sound properties, because there's some sort of a preamp built into the card. If you're using something like this, a dynamic microphone or a condenser microphone that's going into a mixer, then you're already passing a line signal. That's what the mixer's supposed to do. That's the preamp. Just configure it, whichever one you need, depending on what you got. And disable the other one entirely so you don't accidentally screw it up. Because it won't sound right if you use the wrong one. And calibrate everything, configure it up for one, and it just won't come out right with the other. You need to make sure that your volume, your levels on the mic are not like down here or something. Because I don't know if that will have just transferred or not, but you want full signal strength. You do not want any kind of boosting or anything. If your sound card has anything in here for enhancements, turn all of it off. You don't want it. Now, what we need is one of the cables that you're not using with reroute yet. In my case, I was using one of those voice meter outputs cables. What you do is, when you go double-clicking on your line-in or microphone, I had to pause and double-check what the hell I actually was doing here. The line-in or microphone input does not need to be the default, and actually you're not supposed to want it that way. Whatever cable you pick, in my case, I'm using cable A as my microphone input. What that means is, when, let's say, I have open broadcasting software here. This is my what I'm recording with right now. When I'm going into my audio settings, and my actual microphone device is my cable A here. So it's not the actual line in, it's not the microphone or anything like that. It's a virtual device. And this is the cable that is going backwards into your ASIO for all settings. So rather than selecting the inputs and leaving the output alone the way we did when we were setting that up, it's the other way around. Just leave the input unchecked and use the output. What that'll do is send the audio into this guy, and that'll echo it back out here to Windows, and then Windows is, like my program here, able to pull it in freely and use it. And I don't have to worry about any of the volumes here. I don't need to worry about the volumes here. Everything I do is done within the routing system as far as what I want to do volume-wise. So, let's say you got your cable A. This is now your default device. And as always, make sure these are all the same bitrate and sample rate. When you have that calibrated, this is already being input into your ASIO for all. When you have your sound card in there, I believe from the previous video I already mentioned, just to take both input and output. That means the sound card's claimed completely by the reroute. Every sound card may differ slightly, but in my case, there's a wave device that is not being claimed. And this just echoes whatever goes to the speakers, which I later use for other purposes. I'll actually go into that, I think, in this video when I kind of show how the hell I set up the open broadcast. So, when this is all set up, your microphone is already going into the line in, and this goes straight into reroute. Okay, let's get started then. When you're in Reaper, you need to create, just like before, another track. This track is going to be for your microphone. In this case, I'm not really going to go into the other computer and all that mess, the show stuff. If you got this set up to get your outputs already, you've mostly got it done. You already know what to do. Create a new track, and it's mostly the same, actually. I created something that acts as a bus for the cable itself, aka that cable A I use. And this is just a mixer up here. If you hit Control M, you get that view. That's what that is, if you didn't know. It's just another view of the little doodads here, the view meters levels. So in my case, I'm using two additional channels. The cable A channel is functioning as the bus in this case. So for one, no input. Input, none. You're not recording, arming it, or monitoring or anything like that. That's coming in through the mic. And for the outputs, you're outputting it to hardware, which is actually virtual in this case. The cable that we picked as the default recording device in Windows. For me, that's, again, cable A. Right here. Right here. So when you get that calibrated, that's done. Other than the effects. And then the microphone itself is another channel. And just like the other tracks, really, you're taking in. This one is slightly different. You don't need a stereo signal because microphones, at least as far as I'm aware, usually only send one channel on the left. That's it. So you can just go ahead and send a mono channel. And this will have a side benefit later on when you're going through your effects and stuff to pass only a single channel rather than a stereo channel. Because it just takes more work to process them and stuff, and there's a lot of plugins that will have a separate version just for mono, and what it ultimately means is less CPU usage, which can be nice, because once you start going through enough of these filters in real time, it adds latency, and performance stuff tends to get in the way a little bit. More on that later. So, you can just do your mono input instead of stereo and select audio one of your sound card. There's only going to be two, unlike when we had the inputs for the other guy. Where are they? The outputs. The inputs, you only have the two stereo. And that's represented for the microphone, but the right channel will not do anything. The right channel. Once you've got that coming in as your input, one, you can arm and record arm it and monitor on and turn your output, or sorry, right click on your input output, and just like the others, we're going to send it, and you send it to the bus cable track that we made. What is the best terminology? I have no fucking idea. And I don't think I'm doing anything else with that at the moment. But there's a few more cool things you can do with it. Now, from here, we can actually start adding our filters. VST filtration for the microphone. In my case, I'm using a PCI Express card, and there is noise. If you look on my mixer here, when I'm talking, it's bumping up. This bus system has a side benefit. When you record arm something, it turns into a different color. This represents the pre-fader, so that's what's coming in. And when you have the bus, like, designed the way we do without record arming it, it's showing you the output. If you record arm it, it will switch to the other one, and it's like it's redundant and it's not showing you any new information. That's one of the reasons I also use this kind of setup. But notice how when I didn't talk here, it still has noise. It's just going off. I think unless you get a good, like, shielded USB or FireWire interface, you're always going to be dealing with some form of noise. And even then, you may still probably deal with it. That was the original reason I really wanted to get an interface, but then it's like, I need to get a good enough one to suit my new needs, and like, well, I've got something going for me right now that is working pretty much completely 100%, so fuck it. Got time to save or buy other shit, like more speakers or whatever. I'm gonna close this guy. So, what I've chosen to do on the bus, in the effects, I added a single limiter in here just to make sure it never hits past a level, and looks like I'm also boosting it for whatever reason. So, that's that. But we're on the microphone track itself, and you could do it on the cable if you want. It's up to you. It doesn't really matter because it's going through a chain. It's just a matter of if you're using it for other purposes, you'll have to remember which one you're using the effects. Like, for example, if you notice every time I'm talking, it's representing on the cable a track, and it's going out to another track here, and then it's going out to another one here. This is one of my outputs going to my speakers. And I did that simply by, once you have the microphone in this routing system, you just right-click on a different bus. Let's say you want to send it to your speakers to monitor. It just receives, and either cable A or the microphone. I don't know why I chose cable A, but that's the same difference. And at that point, it'll be receiving it, and I can actually... Well, you can't tell the difference, but I can hear myself right now over the music that I'm playing that you probably can't hear. So, what... There's kind of like a fixed set of filtrations you kind of have to go through with microphones, I found. Like, no matter what I tried to do, it was like certain key elements that you needed to go through in a certain order just to get what you want. Which is a clear signal without background noise and maybe allowing you to not get everything picked up by the microphone that you don't want, like, you know, breathing or something, although breathing will get picked up if you're, you know, breathing into the damn microphone. The very first thing you need is some form of special spectral dynamics. I was originally using Melda Production plugins for these, as they were really awesome, but the problem I was having is that if I talked for too long, just randomly out of nowhere, like, the audio would start getting really garbled and stuff, and it would be only on the microphone channels through their plugins, and not, like, my speaker outputs as well, so it was, like, a lot of weird shit going on as far as, what the hell's going on with these plugins? Why are they breaking just out of nowhere for no reason? And I would have to restart or just change some of the settings to have it reinitialize. So I'm like, you know what, fuck this. Once I figured out that must be the culprit, I removed them and I found equivalents. And what I realized is Reaper itself has some good plugins that do the same job. The first one is Reefer. Because the first step you want to do is get rid of background noise. And I'm going to have to kill the music for a moment. It'll show you the, you know, what kind of noise is coming in. When I talk, you can see it does more on the spectrum. It's like an equalizer. But this one has a special function here called subtract. And you select that, you can automatically build noise profile. In fact, let me show you. I'm going to copy and paste this one so I don't accidentally change my settings. Although I'm just going to reload this in the end anyways. Test. Okay, so I just made a simple copy. Sorry about that. I forgot that if I click on reset, it bumps it all back up here again. What you just saw me do is essentially all you need to do. You choose the subtract option. You make absolutely no noise for, say, 20 seconds or so. And tick this box, and then untick it after, say, 20 seconds or so. And it'll continuously move them up to compensate for whatever noise is coming in. So don't talk into it or anything else. So that's basic gist of it, and it usually works pretty well. Like, I should probably listen to myself while I do this, huh? This is what it's like without it. I don't know if you are able to hear it, but it doesn't sound quite right. At least not to me. But there's a noise gate going through here too. Okay, enough of that. Music back on. Okay. Once you've built a noise profile, it'll kind of filter through the majority of the line noise, electromagnetic interference, or if you got like fans running in a sensitive microphone, then this will help you get rid of it. Second step in the chain would be some form of a noise gate. And Reaper has its own. It's called Regate. Ended up being really simple. You just have to drop the threshold. I'm going to delete this guy. There. You need to drop the threshold to a point where the noise is below it, but when you talk, it goes above it. And when it goes above it, you'll see output in here. The levels will bump up. You can see it kind of pulsing right now. That's because the music's, you know, bop, boom, boom, boom in the background. But the microphone just does not send anything unless it goes past the threshold. In my case, I think I picked negative 50. Play around with it, see what works for you. And you'll need to play around a little bit with the attack. And I think the only things I've changed were attack and release. And basically, it amounts to I need a fairly fast attack and a somewhat slow release. If the attack means, like, how fast does it kick in? Whereas the release is how long does it keep it up there open? And with talking, it really helps to have a slower release time, because when I'm talking, and if your voice, you know, in between words and such, tend to, you know, perform gaps in the sound. If the release is too short, this thing's going back down and closing and then reopening again, and then it's got, like, it type of effect. So you'll have to play around with that a little bit, find what's comfortable, what works for you. For me, it ended up being about 300 milliseconds with a really fast 1 millisecond attack time. I don't know if that's higher than the default or lower. Yeah, mine was lower than the default. So, what this will do, it prevents noise from coming in the form of a gate. You have to talk past a threshold volume in order to get it anything through. And that's why you don't see anything on the other thing here. When I'm talking, you can see it bump everything up, but even though there'll be red here, it doesn't get past the noise gate, so nothing ever makes it to the other channels. Even though it's picking up a little bit of my music, you know. So, past that, and this is where it changes a little bit. You have a choice on what you want to do from here. Those are the minimums right here. Some form of spectral type of noise reduction, and a filter, and a gate. In my case, the next step in my chain is actually a limiter. Normally, what I've done in the past was use a compressor. My personal approach to this was, I wanted to talk into this thing, whether it's, you know, quietly whispering or screaming at the top of my lungs, I wanted it to sound consistent so that people, let's say I'm playing a video game and I'm on Ventrilo or TeamSpeak, people aren't like, I can't hear you.
Or hear you too loud, turn your mic down.
I don't want to. So the idea was, regardless of how I talk into this thing, similar to how I leveled out my Windows volume, I wanted to level out my microphone to something consistent. And we do this normally with a compressor. I did it with a limiter just because I liked the way it was working in my case. But normally you would probably put a compressor in the chain here if you wanted that effect. It would bring up the volume that needs to be brought up, but you have to be careful as well whether you're using a compressor or limiter, because if it's too high, you will actually pick up the noise. And what you'll hear is when you talk, you'll see your levels go up, and then as they're going down on that release from the noise gate, right towards the end, you'll hear a noise. If you've got electromagnetic or that staticky sound, you'll start hearing it for a moment. It'll just bzzz before the noise gate closes. So you got to play around with that release time a little bit in combination with what you may be doing right after it to compress it or make it louder. After that, I made it a more consistent, and that was part of the reason I did it this way too, is it just more designed to shrink everything down. Alright, enough about that, because limiters, maximizers. After that, I went through a pitch adjustment. What you're hearing now is not my actual voice. It's going through a very minor pitch adjustment here, and this can add a lot to your voice, so you don't necessarily sound like a squeaky kid or something, but it's really just a pitch shift. I'm not even going to turn it off. I don't need you to hear what I sound like. It's not much different, really, but it'd be, well, one shift semitone up and two shift full range semitones up. Yeah, I totally know what that means. Alright. So, at this point, it's basically just a matter of adding whatever modulation or adjustments you want to do to your voice. This is also where you might want to put in, like, if you wanted a... And I didn't do it myself, or I removed it, rather. I had a voice modulator, what was it, a chorus type of thing, Azurite, that adds a type of sine wave oscillation, or you can configure it all sorts of different ways, and it just does stuff with your voice. Plenty of stuff to play around with out there. In my case, all I'm doing is a pitch adjustment by just a hair. After that, I chose to do an equalizer, and for two reasons. One, because I reduced my pitch, it tends to hit pretty hard on the lows, so I reduced the lows a little bit. I'm using FabFilter. I use it for a couple odds and ends throughout. This one's not free. You gotta pay for it, but there's a million different equalizers out there. It's up to you what you want to use. And I think there's one built into Reaper anyways. And I found that when I cut a little bit towards about 2K, and in my case, whether it's my voice, whether it's my sound card, whatever, that any additional noise that may have still started, that kind of goes through with a louder volume, this range ended up working. Like, as I was talking and playing around with this and moving it around, and I'm not touching it right now because I don't want to fuck with it, it completely killed off the last of that noise. So this is another line of defense along the chain to help filter things out like that, clean it up. You gotta be careful too, because you can really destroy your voice and make it sound like crap. After that is your sort of stereotypical delay or reverb. In my case, I used a delay about 12.3 milliseconds. That's it. It just adds a slight bit of delay to the voice. And after that, my signal was compressed earlier with a limiter. And now I'm using another limiter to smash it up. Maximum threshold, just bring up that compressed signal. Up, 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 because I removed all the noise on the bottom end of the chain. I modulated it the way I wanted, pitch adjusted, whatever. And now we can just crank it the fuck up. So that's what I ended up doing on the filtration filter end of things. And one thing to keep in mind is you gotta be careful with what plugins you choose because of latency. There is, like, we're using this for mostly real-time application in our example. So you don't wanna pick stuff that adds, you know, like 500 milliseconds of delay in the chain, because then you'll talk and it'll take forever to ever get out there. And, you know, that sucks. That's a problem. You'll have to play around with that to see what you can do. And so that whole mess gets passed into my cable A, and then cable A is accessible to whatever the hell I want in Windows. And since that cable is also the default sound device, it will, even if the program, I've had a couple games that had built-in voice chat, that just uses your default device. You can't configure shit. It's not built for people. I don't know. It's just badly designed games or something. Bad software. So, it's like this just works now. I've got my cable A, and at that point, I was happy. I was able to go into my settings. Let's say I'm using Open Broadcast software just to create a video or stream live. I've got my audio settings. I've got something for my microphone. And then I had something for my desktop audio. And this is where things got a little interesting and may differ for how you may do it. The problem with trying to get audio that you're listening to right now, like in Windows or in your games or anything else, to output into software like this, is you need to have something on, not on the recording end, because this is where it's looking for a microphone. That's down here. Now it's looking for a desktop audio type interface. That's whatever's on the far left tab. And the problem was, well, your speakers are already claimed. Like ASIO for all is exclusively controlling this. It can't access it. So you have to basically bounce another virtual cable normally, another signal through a virtual cable in order to give it a available input, as they call it here. But in my case, I was able to avoid that. And just for the record, it'd be almost the same thing as when we set up the microphone. You're outputting into an input. So you'd be outputting, because when you output, it ends up on these anyways, so these would show up as inputs. So yeah, I remember having a little bit of difficulty trying to figure out, well, how the hell is this supposed to loop back, because I need the signal to come back out into like a speaker setup. And I realized that my particular sound card echoes everything. So anything that came through the speakers happened to automatically get spit out into this wave device on the recording side of the end. And I think it was designed normally to, you pass this to your microphone input stuff, and there you go. But in my case, I had to do things a little more cleverly. So I've got this free device. It's not a virtual cable or anything. It was just part of my setup, part of my sound card drivers or whatever. So what I was able to do, and my sound card also happens to have this SPDIF thing, which is something I'm not using, but it's physically here. And the clever thing I came up with was, well, okay, I got a signal that's bouncing back into the other end of the recording chain, or I don't even know what the hell to call it. And there is, and I apologize for the Japanese, and the second tab, at least in my case, is there's two tabs as far as monitoring goes. One of them will just have a checkbox usually. I guess this one does not even have it. The microphone might. But one of the tabs will have a monitoring option, and it passes that signal to another device on the other end of things. So, and you notice my thing is disabled right now. It's because I'm doing it through yet another system, and I'll explain that in a moment. But that free, unused SPIF device, I'm able to echo into it, and I would have to hit this and so on, and then it would literally just monitor right into that. And then this would be receiving the audio that's coming out of my Reaper system, the reroute. So that was a nice little perk, and then that goes in here. I'm not using it physically. I don't have even the cable to use it, but I don't need to. Windows can just use this as a desktop audio device, and I was able to bounce a signal right into it. Awesome. Otherwise, you gotta come up with something else. At the moment, I can't think of anything, and yeah, play around with it. I don't know. So, I had at this point a nice simple setup. I've got my audio, I've got my, like, my desktop audio, I've got my microphone audio, and it comes in, and then I gotta balance it somehow so that the volumes were consistent. Or rather, not consistent, but so that the microphone is audible over whatever it is I'm talking. Like, and for most cases, in my case, it's trying to play games. If I'm streaming or something like that, I needed it to be quiet enough so that if I talk, well, you can hear me. But then the normal volume might be too quiet, and then obsessive compulsive disorder started kicking in. And that's when I came up with this whole ducking method. Not my idea. It's ducking is a thing, but implementing it into this system was a bitch. It ended up being really simple in the end. And what I had to do was I created another track on my routing system here. No input. This is something that only receives signals. I called it ducking out. And it uses, I don't know why I keep closing that. But it's using one of these cables. Let me see which one it's using. It sends to the hardware output. Yeah, there it is. Voice meter 1 and 2. In my case, my thing happens to be, it starts off as a mono signal into the microphone, but it comes out as stereo. And that has its own perks too. Because, especially when you're using like oscillator type modulators and stuff, you can start getting like three-dimensional, no. You get that width effect and stuff like that. And it works for a lot of programs. In fact, I think OBS lets you actually choose whether or not you want to force it to be mono. So it receives audio on both speakers instead of just one, which it would automatically split, which is the standard, I believe, anyways, for these types of things. So I'm passing that signal just like I did to the bus. So the microphone is sending to cable A. And cable A happens to also, I mean, it's sending out to the card, to the cable windows, but it's also sending it into my ducking right here, that channel I just made. And I'm also sending it out to one of my outputs so that I can hear myself on my speakers. It's literally just as easy as taking a box and you can hear yourself and then turn it off. Great way to, you know, sound test and stuff. So this, on top of going out to my cable on the virtual end of things, it's also coming out to this ducking system. And I'm using an extra cable. And the reason my PDF
bounce back thing was on up here on the wave device was unchecked. Like, I'm not monitoring it because I turned that off. I'm not even using it. Instead, I'm using voice meter, the voice meter cable. It doesn't matter which cable you use, by the way. And this is the one that's throwing it out. So instead of receiving the clean normal signal from the cable or the microphone after filtration, I'm going to go through one more step. And if I wanted to bypass that, all I got to do is turn this one off, turn that one on, and that's it. Well, and tell it to use... No, I don't even have to tell it to use a different cable or anything because it all comes out to the same EDIF device, which would be this guy. Oh, this stuff gets nice and convoluted. It'd be so much easier if it was just pure modular or something. Then I can just point and, you know, oh, there, it's over there. And then accidentally disconnect something, and I have no idea what the hell I just did, and it broke, and hopefully I didn't save. But within the ducking system, I basically... Well, this thing is taking in two things. It should be receiving... Okay, it's receiving three things in my case. First off, it's receiving that cable A, which is the microphone. And it's also receiving whichever output represents the audio that you would be sending into your recording system, let's see, your broadcast software or whatever. In my case, normally it would be the output 1, which is the default Windows and interface and so on and so on. I happen to also use a second one as my music. My music outputs to a whole separate channel. And I will go into that in a different episode, different video. Different episode, I like that. Tune in, folks! Unless you forget! Do whatever the hell you want. So in my case, I'm passing both... Oops, didn't mean to do that, but... There. I'm passing two different signals, and it works just fine. So whatever it is that was intended to be heard as speaker output to your recording system will go into this ducking system as well. And the reason is we're using a sidechain compressor. I'm going to turn this off for just a second, do the other one. I'm going to delete the other one, but I wanted to keep it for the video because it's got a nice visual. So this was a, and I don't use it too much anymore. This is a, yeah, that's going the right way. Yeah, that's, that, okay, yeah, that's, bring, pause for a moment. I'm seeing the wrong cable going the wrong way, but it's not, it's, with a sidechain compressor, and I'm using the FabFilter, they had a nice preset for broadcasting that I tweaked to my own preferences. And the way these work is you send the actual audio signal itself through the main input and outputs out from the compressor. This would be your game audio or your music or whatever else. And what the side portion is the actual microphone. This comes in, but it never comes out. So why it's using that input there, instead of compressing based on the volume of the original audio, trying to, you know, compress it or something, instead what we're doing is when there's audio coming in on the microphone, we're reducing the volume temporarily of the main audio. And you've probably seen this type of effect before where you've got music going and then someone starts talking and it just dies down for a moment while he talks and then he stops and the music comes back up. And that's the ducking type of system. And this is something that you got to play around with the setting wise. In my case, I think I had it go down 12 decibels. So yeah, if I have anything playing on one of those channels, it will, when I talk, drop the volume for 12, drop it down 12 decibels while I talk, and then when I stop, it'll come back up. You gotta play around with your release values, how long you want it to stay that way, etc., etc. sidechain compressor. So you might want to find a free one if you want to play around with it. The fab filters are not free, but they're pretty damn awesome. I'm going to turn that back to this guy. It's like, within Reaper, you can pass multiple channels. If you notice the channel here on the meters, there's like smaller versions of them. That's because this is four channels coming in. And you can, and through a kind of a clunky interface, you have the pins where you can route them. So that's where this whole mess, you know, without using the modular VST host plugin, you just send it directly into the plugin. This one's the mini host plugin. This one's free. The mini host VST, it's free, and whenever there's actual sound coming in, they light up. So that's why I like them. It's good for debugging and stuff like that if you got a complex set of things. But in the end, for me, it was like, well, I want to simplify it. So once I was done with that, I just recreated it here without the extra overhead. Although in the case of the mini host, it just works regardless. So it, like, without issue. Although if I open and close it a few times in a different instance, I notice sometimes it tends to make Reaper crash. So it's like, if you fuck with it, it will, well, fuck with you. I'm just going to do a, I'm just listening to myself there for a moment. So let me show you an example of what the ducking does now, because now I'm able to play whatever I'm playing at full volume for the other people. But if I talk, it will, like, you can hear me at the same volume and it'll just kill off the music a little bit for a while, or the game or whatever. And I will utilize, I think I still have it open. No, I don't. I'm going to open up FooBar here, and just a moment. I know people suck with music on the YouTube and play all sorts of weird garbage, but so I'll just, okay, sorry, I needed to turn on the volume here so that I can hear myself, or rather not to hear myself but to hear the music so that I know it's actually making music. So every time I want to talk, it would die it down. You should be able to hear me just fine. And then as soon as I stop, it will resume. Sorry about that. All right. So that's the idea there. And now I don't have to worry about, you know, what's the right ratio of this to this. No, fuck it. Like, I know my signals are almost line level, or worse, -1 decibels, because that's might be what I cap it. And all I got to do is decide how much I want it to quiet down. I went with 12 decibels. So that ended up being a nice complicated solution. And the only thing I need to add now is latency talk, because that's where things got even further complicated, and I had to try and figure out a solution. So, what is the problem? Well, the problem is these effects. Each one of these adds latency, and particularly any kind of spectral analysis type of stuff tends to be very latency-inducing. But I need it. Like, I can't not use it. And that's why you can see a bit of delay between this guy and this guy. And I don't know how well it's syncing up with my actual thing, my own face up in the corner. Whatever. But, like, I had to compensate for this somehow, because if I play audio, you know, if I'm playing a game and I'm talking, I don't want them to be completely out of sync. And once you added the ducking system, it added another layer of complication, because normally if you're using just, you know, the output of your speakers or whatnot, one of those cables, as your source for desktop audio, and you're using your microphone, you know, this cable A, the game audio will be in perfect sync, or at least it should be, because the single limiter that I keep in there is like 1 millisecond of delay or so. So it made it easy to, okay, we can just deal with one problem, right? You just gotta slow down the microphone. Well, you can't do that. You can't rewind time, but there are settings in any of these types of software for the audio where it's an offset. And I had to, you know, I did a calculation. I think I recorded a video or whatnot to see what the difference in time in milliseconds between the input and output was. And it turned out, in my case, to be about 338 milliseconds or so. And that's not exact, but it's close enough. And from there, I was able to create an offset. And what this does is it doesn't rewind time with the mic. It takes your video and audio from the desktop and delays it by that much so that it synchronizes. Okay, so that's all fine and dandy. So now I've got a perfect synchronization going and no problem. Until you did the ducking system. Because now there's another problem. The problem here was that because I'm taking that audio, instead of just throwing it back out into, you know, let's say open broadcast software, this is going to just be my example the whole time, I guess. I'm throwing it into this sidechain filter to be controlled by the ducking based on the microphone. And the way it has to do that is essentially it's being delayed at the same amount that the microphone is being delayed, because it wouldn't work otherwise. So what's going on now is my desktop audio is coming in at the same latency as the microphone is. So everything is shifted. Luckily, there was a setting in here for dealing with that. And in case of OBS, it was in advanced, and there it was, global audio sync offset. And the values are slightly different, and I'll explain that in a moment if I remember why. But I was, you know, essentially I had to shift the main audio and I had to shift the microphone, and then you finally had everything going. And it was the same value, so at least it was simple enough if you could do it. So, okay, everything's fine and dandy. Except I have the webcam thing now. So I can stick my stupid ass face up on the corner somewhere. And that itself has a delay of its own. In my case, I'm using my Android phone through some form of IP camera type software. It's coming in and acting as a device. It's a webcam device. And it's somewhere around 367 seconds of delay or so. And I had to measure that, and I literally was pointing it at the monitor and trying to record at the same time and talk and the microphone and make sounds and play something and beep at the same time and this and that and come up with these values. But ultimately, I knew that 367 milliseconds is how slow my web camera was from the actual audio. The problem is there's no negative offset for the webcam, and I don't know if other software does or not, but there is the use buffering milliseconds in their case. You can't go negative. Like, that won't work. If I try and hit OK, it just reset it to zero. And I don't know what the hell that may have done to the video in real time, but we'll see, I guess. So the problem there was that the video is no longer in sync. First, the web camera is no longer in sync with everything else, and there was a delay between my voice and the video and the webcam. That's a much bigger problem than trying to have my voice perfectly in sync with, you know, what's actually going on the screen, because that's not that big a deal, really, in the end. So I ended up having to re-change the values, and that's where I ended up having to shift my main audio, like, because it would, if they just let you do negative and it would shift everything, everything would be perfect. Everything would be where it wants, you know, where it needs to be. Everybody's happy. No, it can't be that easy. No. So I ended up having to kind of figure out my own way of doing it, and I did that with the global audio being pushed forward by me by the delay of the webcam. And I think, for whatever reason, I don't remember why, I had to maintain the offset of the audio on the microphone. And what that did is, audio still remains in sync, the desktop audio is still in sync with what's going on the screen, let's say your game, and the web camera is now in sync with the microphone, so I'm lip syncing, you know, just, I'm lip syncing. Okay, I'll stop that. So, ultimately, the compromise I came up with is my web camera and my microphone are now 300-some milliseconds different from the rest of what's going on the screen. Big fucking deal. So, that's what I ended up doing. That's, in the case of broadcasting, this is useful for making, you know, video games, when you're streaming stuff, whatnot. I don't know why I'm using this as my recording software, but I'm used to it. I like it. It works. It's lightweight. I like it. So I'll use it. And now I've got a ducking system that works. I can use a microphone and so on and so on. And at any point, if you want to listen to your own voice, you just right-click the input output on one of your buses that goes out to these speakers and tell it to receive your microphone or the cable A, because they're going along the same chain anyways. And then you'll hear yourself and you can just turn it off whenever you want. Really convenient. A lot of stuff you can play around with the routing. And I think that's really about it. There's nothing more for me to add. Hopefully that was useful for somebody out there. I'm not trying to brag about my setup, but it's not exactly a tutorial. Like, this is a very half-assed commitment. Kind of, I don't know what the hell I'm trying to do. Doing something. So, if it helps somebody, great. Got questions, I don't know if I'll be able to help or not. It's like, everybody's problem is unique, and audio is just a bitch and a half to deal with, so, who knows? I realize this video is already pretty long, but I wanted to append this last bit. It's the next day, and I ended up changing my microphone input a little bit here. I've been dealing with bug in terms of my audio coming in from the microphone, garbling up after a length of time, or no reason. I did a lot of debugging today. I found that if I dropped my buffer levels all the way down to like 256 and ran open broadcast software and my latency monitor and a whole bunch of other stuff, I can bog it down enough to where I could recreate the problem over and over within 7 minutes. I had to come up with a better solution because this was happening even at maximum buffer length, and that's not acceptable. And I've already had that happen, in fact, while I've been live, while I've been gaming, I think even in some of these videos, and I'm not re-recording it. See, I wanted to explain a little bit of the solution I found, because by being able to recreate the problem every 7 minutes, I was able to continuously try different things to figure out what the cause of the problem was. And it turned out to not be the software here. It's not the routing driver reroute. It's not Reaper. It's apparently not the software I have running in the background either. Although that can make things worse, but doesn't eliminate it, so that's not the issue. It ultimately ended up being the something between my sound card drivers and ASIO for All, only in regards to the line input. And it doesn't happen with the outputs, so that's really good. But essentially what I had to do was pull the line in device out of ASIO for All. And I did that. I had to go, and I already mentioned it before, that banana, voice meter banana instead of the voice meter. I went and I downloaded that and installed those. Now I have two of these voice meter inputs, outputs. So essentially what I did is I took my line in, that's this dude here, and using this monitoring echo type feature, not this one. This one is supposed to send it to your speakers. This one that lets me shoot wherever I wanted it to. I'm having it go into that last cable that I have added just now. In fact, an auxiliary output is actually shooting it into here. And then this echoes it over here into the recording side. And this is what's going in here now as my microphone input. So there's one virtual device between the microphone and my routing system that basically pulls the microphone out. So, with the line in out, sorry. So it works. I don't understand what the hell the problem is. I've tried different drivers. Maybe it's isolated to my Zonar card or something. I've got three of them. It's not a hardware issue. But, pulling that out and just finding a different way in was the solution. So, if you don't know how to deal with that, this is how. You literally just echo it out and into another device, and then use that as your input to come back in here. And it doesn't seem to be causing any issues. Like, sometimes I will worry, you know, well, all these damn intermediary links, like, this has got to be adding latency or adding points that are going to cause crackling or problems or something. And I don't know. It seems, if anything, it makes it better every time I overcomplicate it. Like, the more complicated it gets, somehow the more efficient and effective things get. So, I don't know. And then, as normal, I was using the ducking system and everything. I had to redo everything. Every time you add a new device into ASIO, you have to reconfigure Reaper a little bit. You have to go back into the audio device and change, like, the first and last. First is the same, but the last has to be scrolled down further. It doesn't automatically add them. And it does a weird way of messing your shit up here. If the items don't append at the very end, you may need to fix it here. So you have to go one through one, or one by one by one, and make sure that your input is still what you wanted it to be, because a lot of times it's going to be something totally different and you're not going to hear anything and, like, what the hell just happened? Another thing worth adding in is that while I was doing this whole process, it happened to me, and it's normal, I guess. Every now and then you're going to need to probably reconfigure your noise reduction plugin. It just can change. Usually every day, at least once, I'm doing a little sound check, echoing that thing back to myself over my speakers, just so I can hear I still sound the way I did yesterday. And sometimes I don't, so you have to come back in here, and if you're using the reverb, then you still keep it the same, subtract, and just hit this button with everything muted, and just leave it the fuck alone for like a good minute. And then uncheck it, and you should be done. So I just wanted to mention, sound check yourself often, just to make sure, because sometimes it could be a whole unknown variable causing interference. Okay, so now I'm really done. My name was Jacob Necrosis. I'm out.